on the discussion of daffodils. I am Dr. Naveen Kumar Jha, Associate Professor in English, RAGS College, Ahilya Asthan. In today's discussion, we first take into account the observation that I have made and the poet has also made. First, we are going to undertake the observation from the poet's point of view, and then I try to find my own observation of nature and natural world. So the poet finds himself as a single or lonely person. It simply implies that poet or a romantic poet is hardly associated with the mood of society, because the mood of society is generally not very much interested in nature or the solution of problem of life through nature. And what the society expects is not very much suited to the temperament of the romantic poet. So we find from the history of romantic poets that they have been lonely among the crowds, as if they are trying to find some secrets of life, some philosophy of life. Or we can also say that we are not in agreement with the social norms or conventions which have been established on the social ground without being concerned with the individual happiness and mirthfulness. Now here it is in that lonely situation the poet, like Wordsworth, is going to find some kind of a company into the nature, and it is why he is just wandering just like cloud. And it is the daffodil that he is looking at. You know, at first he's casually looking at almost 10,000 daffodils. At first glance, it seems that it is just a general common phenomenon that the poet is observing. But from the crowd, he is making the term host. And then from the general observation of the natural thing in terms of daffodils is full with connotative expression. Now, the same daffodil is no longer simply a flower. It refers to angel, and it reminds us the viewpoint of romantic poet who thinks that nature is religion. It is the philosophy of life that we can find from nature, as religion teaches us philosophy of life to live happily. And we can also say that there is a branch of philosophy in religion which supposes that nature itself is the reflection of God. And so now daffodils is just taking the status of angel, the status of God, and it is what the lesson of religious doctrine that we find from that word host. So here we can say that he is teaching the religious doctrine to find certain kind of philosophy to pacify our distorted emotion through the natural beauty. Now we also find that he compares himself to a cloud, or He is participating in that natural phenomenon. The man is not, you know, and man cannot be cut off from the natural cycle. We have cut off ourselves from the natural cycle, supposing ourselves more important than the natural order and world. It is why we have just invited lots of problems. But when we think a chain of natural order, we are naturally participating into the natural phenomenon. So being the cloud is simple expression that the poet is to participate into that natural phenomenon. He wants to be the natural constituent, and he wants to make the cycle complete by being the participant of the natural phenomenon. So here we can say that natural order is just to make life go on smoothly. And we find that it is just going to help us avoid confrontation in life. When actually we are living as the part of nature, we are trying to adapt to natural system. And so here there is less confrontation with the natural world. But when we try to just make ourselves off from the natural order, we are just trying to make a gap between the nature and the human world, and it has just been the reason for making confrontation between human life and the natural life. So we can say that we need not be lonely. We are lonely when just we are simply trying to live into this worldly life without being concerned with nature as our companion. So the poet here is just going to make himself a link with nature, make himself a chain of nature, that he is just trying to fulfill the cycle of natural order. Another point that we can consider here is that he is using two words, rather there are two adjectives that we should consider. One is fluttering, or another is dancing. These are used for daffodils. At first, when we just consider the participle form of flutter into fluttering, we find that it is under certain kind of compulsion that daffodils are just making certain movement, that it is an external force, maybe the external force of wind that has made daffodils move. And it also implies that daffodils are not just interested in doing all these kind of things. When externally we are made to do certain kind of thing like movement, we are doing that kind of thing unwillingly. And here our participation is less, our interest is less, our inclination is less. And so that does not create a very good participation on the part of daffodils also. But from fluttering, we come to dancing. Here, dancing is not passive. You know, it is an active participation. We can be made to move by external force, but we cannot be made to dance by external force. So first, wind is trying to make daffodils move. But when it is fluttering, it is that sort of physical phenomenon which is just taking place all before us and before the poet. But when the poet uses the term dancing for the daffodils, it means that he is just thinking that now from that external force, the poet is seeing daffodils dancing out of his own interest and out of his own personal engagement. Now, daffodils are personally engaged in doing that kind of thing. Now, so unless we are personally engaged in dancing, we cannot dance well. We cannot perform. Any art cannot be performed well unless we are personally internally engaged into that kind of performance. So here, that daffodils are here very much active. Actively, daffodils are dancing, and it is spontaneous. When we are engaged personally, spontaneity naturally flows from us. And it is just like flowing of water, that spontaneously just a stream is converted into the river. It is a spontaneity of flow that the little stream of the Ganga, just at glacier, is converted into the vast river of the Ganga in the plain. So the same kind of situation, serenity is to be observed into dance when we are automatically, we are out of our interest trying to do that kind of thing. So we find that poet intends to say that dancing of daffodils is a sprightly, vibrant dance. It simply means that out of joy we perform dancing well. Out of happiness we perform dancing well. We love doing that kind of thing. And when we love doing certain kind of thing, that work becomes supreme. That work becomes religious. That work becomes, you know, full of artistic passion. You know, it is why just, you know, Lord Krishna had just priest Arjuna to participate in the work with passion. When out of passion we are participating, even in the war, it has the religious tone, you know. So simply speaking, that doing something doesn't mean, unless we are very much intentionally or very much personally engaged into that kind of action. So now it is a sprightly, vibrant dance which has a very much a supreme experience on the part of the poet also. You know, when this kind of thing happens, when the audience on the stage is engaged in certain kind of action, now taking place on the stage, we find that that audience also becomes an integral part of that theatrical activity. Now we cannot say that here the person who is on a stage is only just performing certain work. If the person on the stage is performing well out of the passion, or if it is personal engagement by the actor on the stage, we see that just audience is also going to be very much integrally related to that kind of thing. So there is an integral relation between the observer and the actor and the doer. So we are just finding here that daffodils is dancing to the full of glee. You know, it is here. If we are just performing to the full of glee, it is just a supreme religious overtone that is the result of all these kind of things. So the poet gets infected naturally. When this kind of an artistic work is taking place somewhere, the audience can not be just unaffected from this kind of thing. And actually, when you are in theater and this kind of personal engagement is on the part of the artist, we cannot say we'll be simple just observer there in the theater. We'll be ourselves very much active. And will be imaginatively doing the same kind of thing as the person or the actor is doing on the stage. We are just feeling the same flow of emotion at the actor or the person is just very much doing there. So it is from simple seeing the daffodils, now the poet starts gauging the daffodils. Poet is lost to the dance. Poet is unconsciously just inclined to see what the daffodils are doing there, while the daffodils are simply dancing, you know, with all kind of fullness, with all kind of perfection. So we find that this verb gazed and gazed, that has been repeatedly used in the poem, is just to reflect on the extent of the attention that poet is applying to see this kind of thing. So, you know, it is just from the simple watching, it becomes a religious, observation of the phenomena. So we find that, when we are just participating at some religious ceremony, till we are watching this ceremony taking place, we are just not feeling that much pleasure as we should. When we are just internally participating into that kind of thing, we are equally feeling the same kind of thing. The priest on the one end is doing everything just before the deity, and we too are just imaginatively doing the same kind of thing and feeling the same kind of thing. So here, from just a common flower, daffodils, now daffodils becomes a protagonist of this poem, that he is the main actor who has just cast an impression on the audience, like William Wordsworth. Now they are going to be unified. Now here the separation between the actor and the audience is lost. We cannot, there is a thin line between the actor and the audience. When they are just unified by the same emotion, by the same passion, it is what the classic success of that kind of performance is. So the protagonist daffodils are successful in catching the attention of the audience, William Wordsworth, to the extent that he also gets himself, you know, engaged in that kind of dancing. So we can say that the third stanza, which has been finished with a colon, is an indication that here there is no finality of the emotion that Wordsworth has to express. No, it is just the continuation of that expression that will go to the fourth stanza also. And there too, you know, here it is all the description and depiction of the very much religious dancing by daffodils. But when we come to the stanza 4, you find the poet himself is dancing. Just no matter where he is far away from that kind of thing. But he is dancing, because he has been just overcast with that kind of impression, that it always makes him dance. First, it was breeze to make that daffodils dance. Now, the daffodils make the poet dance and feel the same kind of pleasure. So, it is why the semicolon has been used by the poet, that now from the dancing of daffodils, he is switching to the dancing of himself that he is making, and so on. So we can say that it is just a precious wealth that the poet has taken from this observation of nature. And we can also say that when we are gathering the precious wealth from the nature, it is just very much caught in our memory for whole life. And we can simply not forget that kind of lively memory, as the poet is also saying the same kind of thing, that it is all beautiful dancing that he has seen there just in the well. It's stored in his unconscious mind, and spontaneously it makes the poet, you know, just feel the same kind of thing, pass through the same kind of emotion when he is in his couch and elsewhere, and he is either into the pensive mood or or reflexive mood or contemplative mood, and so on. So we can say that it has been just the cosmic order that the poet has tried to establish. You know, it is all the cosmic order in which we are living when we are just very much observing nature with that kind of seriousness, with that kind of intensity. We are just trying to form a super cosmic order, and it has no matching. This pleasure has no matching, and we simply cannot find any pleasure more viable than the pleasure that you find out of the super cosmic order through the natural beauty. Now, just it is the text that we are simply going to read for you, and here we are just trying to collect some of the difficult word and dictions, and we can just analyze it from just semantic point of view as well. You know, I wandered lonely as a cloud. So wandering is simply just aimless walking without any purpose, and most often you find that when we are aimlessly doing certain work, we are just free of all kind of conflicts of the world, and in that situation our mind is more active, and we can find most of the scientific finding had been made when the people were wandering without any purpose. People were spending their life. Suddenly that scientist and philosopher has realized something supersonic. And so is the thing of the poet, that he is just like cloud and wandering. But when cloud is wandering, it is just a very much a region for the rainfall as well. That is the nectar of the cloud that it tries to pour over the world. So, you know, here and that floats on high over vales and hills. And here, yes, what is the best place to wander? If we want to wander, we should wander in the orchard of nature. Either it is in vale or hill, that can give you lots of opportunity to find something very much cosmic. So the poet has decided wander not in the town, not in the city, but the poet has decided to wander just in vale and hill. When? Because he cannot find daffodils in town and city, because that kind of natural wealth is only available when he is wandering into the natural world. He saw a host of golden daffodils, and besides the lake, beneath the trees, fluttering and dancing in the breeze. So it is all possible in the countryside. It is not possible into the very just what we can call congested city and town, because this is simply impossible to make this kind of natural world available there. So we have just very much found into the second stanza, and we are going to express that it is that kind of glimpse that poet has found while wandering, that is making a comparison to make us convince how many and what was the equality of the beauty of that daffodils. You know, for that he is just trying to find continuous as the stars that shine. You know, we can look at the stars shining everywhere, and we are really blessed with the impression of the shining stars. And similarly, continuously, it was just the daffodils dancing and fluttering. And so, as the stars were twinkling on the Milky Way, and so it is the same Milky Way of water of just lake. It is of the same color we can find. It is the same appearance, actually. We cannot say that the same color, but the appearance is almost same. That is the appearance of Milky Way in the sky. So is the appearance of water in the lake, and on that the same background, their stars were twinkling and their daffodils were fluttering and dancing. And so, as the stars were stretching never-ending line, so the daffodils were also just stretching in never-ending lines. So there was no end as such, as the stars remain uncountable. So is the case with daffodils, that he is not interested rather to count the number. It was host, and it was crowd of daffodils, and it is enough to please us. It is enough to soothe us, you know, when we are seeing plenty of natural objects just before us. It is very much pleasant to watch, and along the margin of bay, 10,000, maybe it is just a calculation and a guess that he is making. So, at a glance, tossing their heads in a sprightly dance, and you know, the waves beside, so dancing is going on just between two natural objects. On the one hand, it is all by the bridge that daffodils are dancing. Similarly here, waves are also dancing. But who did better? It is daffodils which outdid the sparkling waves in glee, because daffodils' dance were more appreciating. And so a poet, wait, and the man of the romantic nature would be happy. Yes, every romantic person would be happy to see this kind of thing. Or we are all romantic by our nature. It is another thing that we have covered our romantic element with what you can call, excessive professionalism and so on. But just inwardly we are romantic. So everybody is happy. And we should be happy, as William Wordsworth is happy, so we do. And in such a jocund company, we should look for, because we should try to just give a space to our natural and romantic mind. You know, that will be very much important for our just healthy mental status too. And so the poet is gazed and gazed, and little thought, when we are unconsciously falling into the beauty of something else, we stop thinking. Loving, starting of love makes us stopping of thinking. We simply cannot think when we are in love. And it is another level. It is just the level beyond thinking. And so the poet is no longer thinking. What wealth, you know, it is nature has just provided him wealth of beauty and so on. So we should be happy, and poet is happy, and so far off. When or on my couch I lie, whenever. You know, it is such a great wealth that we can use anytime, anywhere. You know, it does not demand any kind of condition on our part. You know, the poet here is just far away from that natural places, in vacant or in pensive mood. You know, there is no condition to be happy, to remind all the natural beauty that we have seen. So, because every man has been gifted with a third eye. Just that is an unconscious eye. Unconscious mind is our third eye, where we are storing everything, pleasant and unpleasant, good and bad and everything. Now it is up to you to rejoice or to fall in sorrow. Now it is up to you to utilize that unconscious mind, either for our healthy mood or for sorry mood. But the poet is always going to just utilize the bliss of solitude. You know, just we will be just happy when we are remembering the good thing and good part of our life, you know. Although we know that life is made of so many torturous feelings as well, but why to remember those torturous feelings? Instead of remembering those torturous feelings, just the poet prefer remembering that beautiful thing that and beautiful wealth that the nature had provided him. So, and now he is just going to be unified, and then my heart with pleasure fills. Now the line is just lost. There is no line of demarcation between daffodils which were dancing there, and here in the lie the poet is dancing. And so this is what just a kind of unification is, and dance with the daffodils. And it is where the two things become one. The two natural objects are simply unified when we are at the same level of emotion, at the same level of intensity for love and so on. So it is what we can find a very religious tone is given into that poem. Now we can say that we have chosen some words for you students that we can always remember. As I have already told you, wandered, it is just a verb for you into V2, walked aimlessly. Float is also once again verb for you, that is drift. Well, it is noun, valley. All at once, suddenly, it is adverbial in nature. And a host of, it is phrase, plenty of. It is, prepositional phrase and something like that. Golden, from gold, we have made it into adjective of gold color. Beside is conjunction, that is near. Flutter, I am just what you can call verb. Wherever, bridge, It is noun, rather abstract noun, gentle-winged Milky Way galaxy. Once again, we can say that it is also a kind of abstract noun. A stretch is a verb, reach, margin, border, edge. It is noun. Way, a part of the coast where the land goes into form a curve. So it is a geographical phenomenon. And there you find land is going to form a curve. So that part of geographical structure is known as bay. At a glance, suddenly, immediately, upon looking something sprightly, it is a sprite. From that sprite, we have meditated for sprightly, intrinsically. So actually, we have taken the meaning from intrinsic into adverb intrinsically. Toss, verb, to throw something lightly and carelessly. Outdo, it is once again verb, doing more. Importantly, doing something better than other. And sparkling, it is just sparkly. Effervescent, rather. Glee, mirthfulness. Gay, jovial. Mirthful and jocund, merry. And companion. Gaze, stare, often. And couch, sofa. Lie, rest, dwell. Vacant, blank, pensive, reflexive, contemplative, mood, temper, flash upon, show off, bliss, perfect, happiness, solitude, loneliness. So I have collected all the important words that poet has used in this poem. And there are so many words which are just directly taken from the religious side, like solitude. It is once again a term that is religiously discussed. Glee is also the same kind of thing that we find jocund. So we find that this poem has philosophical and religious contemplation. From the ordinary observation of daffodils and its dancing, the poet has made it to the height of religious philosophy of life that he tries to make when we are ultimately going to merge with the natural world. That is what our life is. That is what his philosophy is that he tries to present here. And I think that we have discussed it well and we have understood.